Record. Okay, then let's start, guys. Yeah, so today I will show you how Andrea, Lars, and Arvid and me created this environment chart, which is pretty huge and also pretty long, like I think 400 frames. So I don't really have an exact plan what we will do, but I will just improvise. This is not going to be about Houdini, this is going to be about Max, and maybe I can show Substance Painter because I did use Substance Painter for this one a bit, at least for one asset. So I would say let's just start. And oh wait, of course I'm not streaming, that's a classic. Thank you for reminding me. Okay, cool. Now it I should be streaming, right? Can you see my screen now? Okay, awesome. Okay, cool. So I didn't show anything anyway, so I just played the shot itself, so you already saw that. So the first thing I will talk about are our references, because this is how you start every project, and we gathered together a lot of references from the actual movie and from the actual location in New Zealand, and we split it up in multiple areas so it's easier to organize. Yeah, for example, we have some shots, some close-up shots, so we see a bit more architectural detail and how the cliffs are shaded and lighting-wise as well, you know, because we didn't decide too early where we want to go with the lighting. We did the layout first, and I actually have a work in progress folder, so we can. This is actually quite interesting because this is the first stage of the shot. Just to block out everything, where the camera is and where should the city be and where are the cliffs, you know, and we were pretty close to the layout from Weta Digital, which we didn't like copied, but I mean it's written there, so it should be somehow the same, you know. So this is the first pass basically, just to show what we can see and how the lighting works. And I'm gonna just scroll through these for now. And yeah, this is was the first approach with the background foreground integration, where we had this like of a kind of U shape, but this was a bit too simple, so we definitely changed it later on. Yeah, this was also this was one of our main references for cliffs. This is a reference pack I bought from ArtStation. You can actually Google Rivendell reference pack and you will find it. It's actually from the guy who did the matte paintings on the actual movie, so these are all the original files you can actually get. Maybe I can go through them even. Where's my references folder? Give me a second, guys. Oh yeah, here it is. So this is the folder, and this is really, really helpful in terms of seeing how, like, what kind of vegetation is there, and how the shading layer, like, or like, what kind of layers the texture of the cliffs have. Yeah, and these are actually used in the movie. That's kind of crazy. Maybe not exactly this one, but some other ones. It's pretty cool. Okay. Yeah. So this was the introduction of the river, which we later on changed a lot, because this looks kind of low res, and I did this with a simple displacement and the texture, but it looked very, very low res. So I decided to change that later on. And also, these cliffs were just placeholders, just to block out the shapes of the cliffs. By the way, the cliffs, it's a mixture of Houdini cliffs and Megascans cliffs. Mostly we used Houdini, and I can show you how I did that. My friend Adrian Lambert gave me his tutorial on Gumroad. Like, where is it? this one, procedural glyphs within side of Exodini. So I basically did that, you know, so there's no reason to show it because that would be a steal from Adrian. So if you're interested how to create those kind of glyphs, you should definitely check him out. It's definitely worth it because I mean you have the power to create anything, I guess. Let's just keep scrolling. So this is actually the look, the first look on the lighting, which is pretty close to the reference, which we can see here. So these are my personal references, like this one. This one, for example, I think this one is used. This panorama is used in the movie. I try to nail the look and colors of this reference, right? But we decided to, oh, well, I decided to change it a bit later. So this lighting was just achieved by a simple V-ray sun and some area lights which cast on the cliffs, but it looked very artificial and not very natural. So we changed that later on. This was a more reddish, like eveningish approach, and this was already closer to what I liked. This is more like this kind of look, what we decided to look better, you know. And in the end, I also tried in a more natural kind of look, which was more closer to the normal Lord of the Rings look, you know, like this kind of normal sun, I guess. And later, we decided to go back to. This was actually the final lighting setup. So, more like a morning sun, I would say. This was just slab comping tests, and yeah, but you know the final look. This is actually pretty damn the final render setup. So, you see how the final render looks in the raw render, and the I can. Wait a second, let me open the Rivendell shot itself again on Vimeo. And you can see how crazy the difference is between the raw render. And this is not because of comp, of course, it's also compositing, but the grading was actually a hard carry in this one. But yeah, I would say let's just hop into Max. So, in order to be more performant, I split up the scenes in foreground and background, and these two have the exact same lighting setup, but in this one I just added a light blocker, so it fakes like the mountains on the left side, so we only get light on the right side, like kind of a rim light on the edges here and on the vegetation. The trees are simulated in SpeedTree, so this is nothing special, just fast SpeedTree setup and then wind and export it. So this is actually, I think I even bought these trees in the SpeedTree library for like $10 or so. And this path is actually a Megascans asset, which I textured in Substance Painter. And we can maybe dive into the forest pack setups. Or maybe I should open the original scene because this is just an Xref scene. This is the render scene. I guess this one. Didn't open it for a long time, so. Okay, but then, meanwhile, let's talk about the background. So, first, everything started with the block out. So, like I showed you earlier, we actually used these geometry later. Just to know where things are, and we started populating the city with a lot of other stuff. The buildings were modeled by Andrea. He's also here, I think, in the stream. Is he not? Okay, unlucky, he's not here. Never mind. Okay. Let me switch to perspective. Thank you. So this is how the scene looks. This looks kind of cheap, but I mean, doesn't matter, it works from the camera point of view, so who cares, I would say. Let me switch, turn off the waterfalls. By the way, this is a funny thing, because the waterfalls, they might look kind of good in the, or they might look good in the shot, but the waterfalls are actually just planes. As you can see, they're just, so Arvid rendered the waterfalls in Houdini, and I just projected them onto the plane, and then just displaced it a bit, so, let me turn off the stuff, because this is quite heavy. So yeah, I decided, I tried also like a real 3D waterfall sim to put inside Max, but that was just overkill. I mean, it's... Oh, God damn it. Thank you. So yeah, this is just a simple plane displaced. Oh yeah, thank you. I can put it on. So this is Andrea, who modeled the buildings. And this is a really, really good asset. This is true film quality right here. So yeah, and he's now modeling at Scanline VFX in Germany. Let's say he's a modeler, not modeling. Lul. Yeah, but this is a really great asset. Yeah. So back to the waterfalls. This is just a simple plane. With a noise on top, and then just move the vertices around, so it actually looks like it's hugging the cliffs, you know. And yeah, so these cliffs are, like I said, for the city cliffs, they're just all mega scans, and I think lot zero. Yeah, lot zero, and then just I scattered vegetation on top of them. So maybe we can take a look on the vegetation itself. I think it's here, yeah. So there are four layers of vegetation in the city here, and also another layer of props, which I will talk about them later. Let's start with the trees. So when it comes to a city, and what makes it look real is like different layers of scatterings, right? So there's not only trees in a city, there's also like little grasses and little bushes and all that stuff. So that's what I also set up. So you see these little this kind of little pyramids, that's actually like little moss and little grasses like scattered all over the place. So it never looks like just like concrete, because if you look at the original movie, it also looks very dense and very lively, and a lot of trees and grass in the city. Look, there's no like actual like concrete ways, at least not that much. So we try to do the same thing, like a lot of vegetation in the city, so it looks like closer to the nature, which actually the elves are also, or alps are actually doing. So yeah, that's the key here. This is just a pretty simple setup here, nothing special, just a lot of proxies. By the way, everything as much as possible is a proxy here, just to keep it keep the viewport a bit lighter. So we have like a different kind of trees with different scale and different probability, and just, yeah, I think for the distribution I just it's not that dense, and I just picked this map because it looks kind of real or like natural. I think I also did like groups and patches, but that didn't work that well, so it should be pretty dense but not too dense, so this one worked. Yeah, also a must do for natural scenes, in my opinion, is creating these clusters, because when you do just put it random, I mean, I can turn on the material color right now. Hopefully this is not too slow. Okay, yeah, so you see each type of tree has its own color now. Because if you do it random, it looks very random, and it's never like this in nature. In nature, you have like a group of the same species on the same place, and then you have the next species next to it, right? So that's why I decided to do these clusters, because now you actually have like little groups of the same type of a tree, and which looks way more natural, and it even works better on on the whole background terrain. Maybe I can bring back some references from these, because here you can see you have like similar trees right next to each other, right? And then you have these kind of trees all over the place, and maybe some other type in it, you know? And yeah, I just try to do the same thing. Okay, let's talk about the shaders of the buildings. Oh, no, let's talk about the props first, because the props are just randomly scattered all over the place on the whole city. And what we have in the props is actually from Kitbash 3D, and just a simple wood texture on it. So everything has just like a simple wood texture on it, basically, because it's so small you would not see it, but it still had to look like something. So let's open the forest pack for the props. This is just, I think I didn't even turn on, oh okay, I did also cluster, so there's like little barrels right next to each other, so it doesn't look like random. And I also did like a stack of geometry, so it doesn't look that super random, but rather like someone placed these things there. So you could say it's like more like a Megascans assembly together, and then I scattered the assembly. So yeah, yeah. Let's talk about the shaders of the buildings, because this is all done procedurally. We didn't have UVs, so I also told Andrea to not care about UVs and to get too much detail in the geometry, because it's so far away. And we had actually a version of this gate, for example, where it had way less detail. But when it's so far away, it's all about the shapes, right? And about the rough geometric details. So we decided to add things like this on the side, you know, things like this, because otherwise it looks just like a boring straight thing. And that's how you get nice detail in the geometry. When even if it's far away, you will not see maybe not see these guys, but shapes like this, you definitely need them to make it more realistic, right? So let's take a look at on the shaders, because they are pretty. Here you go. So yeah, this is just my favorite thing to do: triplanar the shit out of these guys, and random texture offset to just make it not look all the same. Yeah, maybe I can even show this guy, because was the first test, actually. This is the first work in progress scene, where I just tested how the concrete works, how does the tree shading work. And my headset just died. Awesome. So, by the way, here you can see the cluster setup very well. You see all this kind of similar trees in this area, and then you have like a cluster of similar trees here, and then it gets broken up again by some other trees. So that's how it looks, kind of natural, you know. So yeah. Okay, cool. Concrete setup. Nothing special, just a texture from texture.com. This was too saturated, of course. So I just color corrected a bit, so it looks more gray, more like in the original movie. And also, this texture had a nice line of darkness, like here this leakage, you know. So I did an offset in the triplane texture, so it works exactly for this item here. So the leakage is actually here, under the surface, you know, here. Okay, so then there's not like something special about the roofs, because I have like four roof shaders, and everyone has like So this shader is actually made for the closest one, so it has dark, bigger tiling in the bump map. So oh, never mind. This is no. Okay, cool. So this is the bump map I used. If I had used the setup from the other rooftops, you would not see the details because they are so small. So that's why I did another shader just especially for this roof here, and also the tiling in the roof texture is way bigger. Maybe it's also interesting to show this later approach. So this is actually with the final grading, and yeah, this is pretty old, I guess. This was the first pass from compositing, so he added more waterfalls in the background in comp. Just I gave him a rough geometry so he knows where to place them, and I gave him the renders from the waterfalls, and when he built this setup here, he also added like a foam from the waterfall, which appear usually on the end of the waterfall. And that was an idea from him, and I really liked it, so we decided to introduce it on all the waterfalls, which are bigger, so on this one and this one later too. This was a later version with more waterfalls, I think. Yeah, exactly, because it was too simple, so we decided to create more of these thinner stripes, and also some birds. They are really bright here in this version, so I gave a note to just make them darker and make it more alive on other parts as well, like place some here maybe, and maybe some here in the foreground. And there's another work in progress, I see. Okay, yeah, this one. This was pretty close to the final. Even with the birds below, and I think was there anything else? Oh yeah, I think yeah. So the sky was a bit too bluish on the top, so we had to make it brighter and a bit more orangey, so it fits to the scene, because there was a huge contrast between this sky and here, and it looked kind of weird because it blends in with the cliff, which would not happen. So yeah, that's it. Back to the textures. You see, this is not organized. I'm just improvising right now. Yeah, this is like really nothing special. Just some textures.com textures applied, and then, or maybe this texture, this shader is maybe different, because I had a rooftop setup where I had like a randomized hue, saturation, and gamma for each roof. So each roof looks unique, you know. So I had like a different kind of textures, which randomly get chosen from the multi-subtext texture. And I also did a UV randomizer, so it randomizes which part of the texture is shown. And also, I think I turned on stochastic tiling, exactly. So what this does is, on textures like this, you will see the tiling pretty easily on this size, right? And to avoid seeing the tiling, you can turn on the stochastic tiling in V-Ray, and it will fix this issue. It will blend multiple layers of this texture together, so you will not see the seams. And did you paint any textures for of these are far away? No, I didn't paint anything on the this is all procedural. The whole city is completely procedural. I only use Substance Painter for the foreground element on this path here, because I will come to that later. I will come to that later. But I can already tell you, I only use it for this path here. Yeah, so this is what I did for the rooftops. The ground texture, or the ground shader, is just a simple concrete shader. Nothing really special. Everyone can do that so super easy. It's I can show it. This is just how it looks, right? Looks like tiles, like super dirty tiles. And of course, my reference was kind of this color, so I did this pretty much the same. Yeah, just to get close to the reference, and also here again to make it not look like it's tiling, stochastic tiling on. Yes, so this about the shaders. I mean, I would show more shaders, but it's basically all every time the same, you know. It's just It's so far away, so why would I waste time to create dirt mask or whatever if these textures already work? But also a little fun fact, we had like actual humans standing here, which I made by the populate tool in Max. There's like a populate tool where you can just scatter people and make people walk from A to B, but it wasn't necessary on the 3D side because it was so small and it was just taking RAM and it was taking a bit too load, so that's why I removed them and we decided to make that in comp actually. I mean, I can open the scene again because I think that's a thing that nobody really notices, or maybe not a lot of people, but there's actually people walking here in the on the gate, for example. And this is all done in comp. By the way, my friend Lars Vemir, he has a YouTube channel and he will post a tutorial about this. And his YouTube channel is, one second, I'm gonna open it for you so you don't have to search for it. It's actually this guy, LoveVFX. So he will post a tutorial in the next week or so. He already sent me the script of a tutorial, so it's gonna be done soon. Yeah. So yeah, definitely check him out. He will post this tutorial soon. Okay, this is about the foreground and the city. And now let's check out the background. And the terrain. So in the beginning, I had a terrain which was made in Gaia, which was overpowered. Basically, it was just too detailed and it had too many height variation. So when I went back to my references, and I have to open them again. Sorry, references. Oh, there you go. So this is my favorite references. So there are a lot of panoramas shot in. That's what she said. They are shot in New Zealand, and yeah, I think like this looks quite like in our reference. Like the raw texture itself looks quite similar, so that's a good hit. And yeah, what I realized is, you never have this kind of sloping I had in earlier versions. So I w rather wanted something like this. So it's like more flat in the middle, and you have like this sloping up to the hills. And I did exactly the same thing in the later versions. So I mean, this is already the final look. And earlier, maybe you remember, but it was like here, like more hilly. But that's what I changed here. Yeah. So this is like a more flat approach, like exactly like here. There's like even better references. I will answer your question in a second. Where is it? No, not this folder. Aha! Here it is. So this is my main reference. This was my main reference for this area. So you see, like there's like smaller elevation variations here, and a pretty flat surface, and there's like a river in it. So that's what I wanted to do too. Like break it up with like some smaller cliffs like these ones here, and then have a river flowing. Like it gets broken up by the forest and stuff, you know? Because here you see it's not always in the same direction. Like you never can see it all the time, you know? So that's what I did as well. And for the sun reflection, although never mind, before I forget it. This flare, I asked Lars to create this flare also in comp, so it looks it's basically the same flare, which is not that recognizable, but yeah, now you can see it, because you always work with references, right? And that's how you do the best images. Just keep look at the real world and recreate it. So that's what we did here as well, and maybe there are some. Oh yeah, here you can see how bright the river gets when the sun hits it. So that was my reference for the spec level. and especially this one, because you see this gets so bright, and that's why it's getting so bright here as well, you know. I could have dialed it down so you can see the color a bit, so because I also made it greenish like here, but that's not how it would look like, so I just let it like it was. How are the trees made? The trees are made in SpeedTree, and some trees are also from the Cosmos browser, which is actually a really nice feature from V-Ray. Because they're not animated trees, but you can actually go to the vegetation tab, and they are in your subscription for free, so you can just use them. It's like a Megascans library, basically. And please load, thank you. So this can take a while. So basically, you have a lot of tree models in here, which you can just import to your scene. So you just download them and then hit import, and they're in the scene, set up with shaders and all, you know. So it's really cool. I used some of these trees. Yeah, but we can take a look on the forest pack. But again, this is actually the same procedure than on the other ones, just different probability for each tree. So not each tree is you can not see each tree the same times, you know, and then just clusters, and the same procedure as everywhere, you know. I do the same basically here, and also random scale, random rotation, and a bit of translation. And it was pretty dense. I had versions where it was denser, but it didn't look like in the references, because it's not too dense. You can still see the single shapes, you know, and that's what I tried to go for, just like Mesh and Maya. Yeah, but I would say Forest Pack is definitely 10 times better than Mesh. There's so much things you can adjust, and the distribution maps and all that shit, you know, it's just 10 times better. Can we scatter speed trees into Forest Pack? Yeah, ex that's exactly what I did. So I did some trees in SpeedTree, imported them here, and then I just you can b scatter a anything you want in Forest Pack. It's not like just a Forest Pack for their own library, which there is obviously. There's a library for Forest Pack itself, but you can scatter anything you want. You can also scatter buildings or I don't know, anything you want. I could also have scattered rocks on the cliffs, which was not visible, so I didn't do that, you know. You can scatter anything you want, and there's like also like a different different layers, like how, just in real life, how there like there's a lot of layers of what you can see. For example, there are like some bigger rocks here, and then there's like a really big rock, and then there's just like sand, you know, and that's what I did here as well, just some different layers of rocks, bigger rocks and smaller rocks, like denser but very small rocks, and then also some little shrubs. Yeah, this is the setup of the terrain and cliff scattering, you know. Also, to be more precise, I didn't scatter my forest pack on the V-Ray proxies of the cliffs. I actually scattered them on another proxy, so I have a low poly version of each cliff here, and I scattered them onto my proxy, so it's more precise. And because sometimes it doesn't work on these kind of point clouds, kinda, you know. So forest pack does not know where to scatter things, because there's not much geometry. So that's why I always have a I had a proxy version of the cliffs. The water is not simulated, so I will come to that. The water is actually just a plane, and what you can do in with Phoenix FD ocean textures is so what it is basically is just a procedurally generated displacement map, right? So this is just a I can turn the scale a bit down, so you see how it looks, right? And actually, it moves, it's animated, so you can just change the rate of change, and then it's getting slower or faster, whatever you want. And you can actually also change the direction where it's flowing to. So right now, this was working already, so this is flowing from right to left, right? So it makes sense, because this is the highest setup here, and when it just flows down, and this is just you see, I did this waves pretty small, but It's such a nice detail, and it looks so real because it's actual kind of real water, you know, but it's not simmed. It's just a texture, an animated texture, and from this far away, it works very well. So there's no reason to simulate water when it's so far away, when you can just use a texture, and this is the best thing you can actually do, in my opinion, for this kind of scenarios. And I know that in production, a lot of companies use the same technique, like just Phoenix FD, multiple layers maybe if needed, and then what is also an important thing on the water is this is just not just a water shader. This is a shader with foam in it. If you take a look on the edges of this building, for example, you see that there's like foam around the corners everywhere, and also on these rocks here and here, everything which is in the water and where the water hits the geometry, it's getting hit, you know. So, oh, Lars is here, by the way. Hello, Lars. Nice to see you here. LoveVFX, that's the guy here. That's Lars. That's very cool that he's here. Okay, nice. So how did I achieve this look in the water? So there's a little trick. So this is just the V-Ray blend material, and the water shader is like pretty normal, just a bit of diffuse and not complete refraction, so it looks a bit dirty. And then I did a foam material, which is just white and pretty reflective. And the blending amount is just controlled by a distance texture, right? So what it does is, let's say I connect my distance texture. Like I connected these guys into my distance texture. What it does is it creates a white fall off around the rocks, and the further it gets away, the blacker it gets, right? So it's white around the closer to the edges, and then it fades out to the black. And I broke it up with a bit of noise. So the white area on this texture is controlled by a noise. So it's ju not pure white, but rather it's like a bit broken up, like real foam, because foam is never just a fully white surface, right? It's always a bit like this little air bubbles, you know. So this is just a whole list of geometry which gets fed into the distance texture, and the same thing for no, that's not the same thing. So there's actually also like a little like foam. You can see these foam things here. It's like little foam on the in the middle of the ocean, and that's I made it by using I created this based on an image. I can actually show you the image. This is quite funny. So let me check. Rivendell. Okay, foam. Yeah, so this is the texture, and it's animated. So I did that in After Effects. I just put in a texture from textures.com, which is just a foam texture, and then I made it black and white and high contrast, and then I just added some modifiers on it, you know, so it looks like this. And this is my mask, and I added the same material, or rather it's pretty much the same foam material, and it's controlled by an animated noise like this one here, you know. When I just made a triplanar, and I also made a I had to just die again. Cool. And I also put in stochastic tiling, so you don't see the tiling. Okay. That's about the water. Is there anything else you would like to know about the background scene? Because otherwise, I would jump to the foreground scene. Just write your stuff in the chat. Maybe the lighting setup, it's nothing special. The lighting is controlled by a simple dome light. I had different versions of a lot of light setups, but it didn't work that well, so I just used a Sky HDRI. Yes, I did use the Sky AGI for the lighting, but it doesn't show in the final render. So the sky in the final scene is just an image, which I use a lot. So I basically gave Last my texture, which is this one. So there's like a dramatic skies and my Dusk and Dawn skies pack, which have a lot of skies. And they are really helpful, and I don't know, there's not a better sky pack I've ever seen. So, and these guys are only like $5 each. Like the pack itself is like $5, so I can really recommend using them. So because they, I mean, it looks real because they are real, right? This is real photography. So, we picked one of these images and we projected it onto a plane in a nuke. So. That's the thing, but you will see it on Nuke's on Lars' tutorial. He will post it. By the way, Lars, can you write maybe when you will release the tutorial? I didn't look at the script yet. You can write it here, or maybe write it in the private chat. Thanks, Johnny. That's the link exactly. Photobash.org. That's an awesome website, by the way. If you hear me, Lars. Write it to me. Otherwise, yeah, that's just a plane projected onto a card. Is LOD on models is also driven by? No, I did it by hand. So, I knew that I don't need like high res meshes on the things far away. So I just created multiple versions of the cliffs. Okay, so Lars said in 2 weeks he will release the tutorial on YouTube. So yeah, where is the Discord here? Okay, yeah, then I would say let's go to the foreground scene. Oh, by the way, before I forget it, this looks a bit weird, all the circles here, but these guys are actually there to control where the forest pack is and where it's not. So all these planes are exclude areas in my forest pack. So I had it driven by a texture before, but every time I change the terrain or adjust it, it looks weird and it will not change it properly. So what I did is I created this exclude areas in my forest pack. So let's go to the area. So there's a lot of circles and it's way easier for me to control where the forest is by just moving around the circles, right? So I had full control of the shape, no matter how the terrain changes, right? If I was to replace the terrain, I could just apply it, and it will be still in the same areas. But every time I would change the terrain and I will control it by a texture, it will not work because maybe the texture orientation is a bit different on the geometry because the UVs are different, you know? So. That's how I control this one. Let's go to the foreground. Yeah, so I'd already talked about the lighting setup. This is the same. Oh, by the way, maybe I can show the AGI I used, so you know. It looks quite different than you might think. So this is the texture. It's not that. It doesn't look that much like a morning. This is more like daylight, but I think I did the intensity of the dome light a bit. Okay, no, it's actually four multiplier four. Okay, interesting. So yeah, that's nothing really special. Just a HDI plugged in, and then a light blocker for the foreground, and I didn't even use a light blocker for the background because I didn't need it. There's a lot of cliffs which already block the sun, so that's it. Nothing special on the lighting side. Yeah. For the key light, you use CG Sun. Oh, you're competent. You mean, what? Do you mean? You mean this one here? This here? I guess you mean this one. What color space? So we used ACCG. This is every project I do is ACCG. Main orange light on the whole scene. Yeah, this is just from this is coming from the AGI. It looks like this. I didn't do anything on the AGI. It looks like this by default. This is just AGI, and for the foreground, I actually added another key light here. I just saw it. What it does is I forgot about this one. So my AGI didn't get the nice highlights on my foreground, so I faked it in this scene here with the another area light. Which is just a disc light, so I made it a disc because the sun is round, you know. Simple thing. And then a warm temperature, and then just made it hit the right side of the cliff. So yeah, I mean you can see what it hits, you know. That's it. That's nothing special. This is yeah. Oh yeah, and by the way, if you have comp questions, you can ask them already in the chat. Lars will answer them. Yeah. Okay. So that's about the lighting setup. And so let's talk about the path. So this path is actually this is a full Megascans path. I just kit bashed together a lot of cliffs and made a shader for it, so it looks like one object. This is just nothing special again. Actually, since this guy had UVs already from Megascans, I just awesome. Okay, I can't you open UDIMMs. So what I did on this one is I went into Substance Painter. Maybe I have it still open somewhere. Maybe I can open it. I don't know if I saved the Substance Painter file. Probably not because it was so easy. Okay, I don't think I had it. Quit. Never mind. Okay, so what I did is I just added a mega scan, added two different mega scan shaders in it, and then I just did like procedural masking, like and I painted some areas. So on top where people would walk, I did like a green, like a more vegetated scene. You know, it's like green on top here. And then it's like rock texture on the sides, like here. That's what I did. That's what I used Substance Painter for. I had it done in shading and procedurally, but it didn't look that nice, so I had full control in Substance Painter. And yeah, when I just placed some hero assets here, I hand placed them in the foreground, so you see a bit of vegetation on the sides, on the cliffs in the foreground, you know. You can actually see here because it looked so naked without, so it just had to be done, you know. And yeah, that's that part. And for the forest pack setup, again, I just scattered multiple layers of bushes and little shrubs and little grasses, just everything you see on this kind of cliffs. And my reference for this was actually from the movie, so let me load my other reference really quick. So I took a look at what we can see here on this scenes from the movie, and you see a lot of like this kind of ivy-ish style, and then you can have like little shrubs, little grasses, little color variations. And do you have? I had like points on CG textures. So the question is, do you have a subscription for CG textures or just free version? Usually, I have some leftover points, but I don't think I have any more. I think I have used them all by now. But sometimes I also just use free version. I think even on the roof textures on the buildings, I used the free version because it was like 500, well, 1024, I think. It was way more than enough from this distance, you know. Yeah. But yeah, so this was a nice reference. So I saw what kind of vegetation you can see here. So I looked into the Cosmos in the browser here, in the V-Ray browser, what we have already, and then the rest would be just mega scans. I already said it in the last masterclass in my arrival scene. I never use the default textures, so I always change them. I always change the color at least. And for this one, I try to do the same colors as here. Some are really dark, some are really bright, and they kind of get lost in the shadow. But I mean, I know it's there, and it looks kind of it still feels right. Here you can see the different colors. You know, I mean, it looks kind of right. So definitely, it was the right decision. Yeah, that's about the foreground vegetation. And the trees are I already said it, they are made in speed tree and they have a point cache, which is really performant, because if I had just one tree I could actually play it in real time, but since I have like three or four, it doesn't work. Let's say I have more trees than that, I would have done a V-Ray proxy, an animated V-Ray proxy for every tree and then place them. But here I was just too lazy and I didn't care. So I know this is, it renders pretty fast anyways because I split it up in foreground and background. So why would I bother it making it? Because sometimes it takes a long time to create these proxies. And this is like a frame range for like 450 frames. So why would I do that? A small tip, if you want to do that, you can actually make it loop. Like, let's say you have 100 frames of animation, which doesn't take too long to cache, and then you can just make a proxy for it if you before looping, I mean after looping the animation. And there's a tutorial on Vimeo. One second, Vimeo speed tree looping. There you go. This is the tutorial. So you can, he shows how to set it up in Max, so you can actually loop the animation instead of caching 700 frames or what, you know. Then you can just export it as a proxy, which goes way faster. This would be the right thing, but here, yeah, like I said, I just didn't care. And again, for the colors, my orientation was clearly in these kind of color tones, so I changed the colors of the diffuse texture for all the trees here. No diffuse of speed tree would work by default, so I had to change them all. Yeah, I would say yeah, that's it. Maybe I can show how the scene looks, because I also made like fake cave light blockers here, so the light doesn't get in from behind and from above, because that's not how it would work in the real life. You know, when you have a path like this, you would be surrounded by rocks, right? So I just placed dark huge cubes just to block the light. Yeah. Anything else? Did I forget anything? No, right? Or maybe I can show you the very first. Well, that's maybe funny. I did a previous on YouTube. I did this and I asked my Arvid what he thinks of this block out. And this was actually the shot, the first ever. Just to get the feeling, and I don't know if you have sound, but you probably don't have sound, right? I think you don't have sound. No, you don't. But yeah, this is this was the first block out, and it was already clear that we need to show the city way longer than that, because this was just like 10 seconds, and it's not even the whole shot. So I doubled the length of the final shot. Yeah. Arvid is typing. It was a great blocker for sure. Oh yeah, for sure. It was really helpful to see where we need to place things and what works. Because this was already way better than the other block out. I can open it again. This was just a mock-up in the render. It was later, but this didn't work at all. This is like this doesn't look beautiful. So I'd rather place like different depth layers of trees on each side, so you could actually you would look naturally on the city, right? Because of the composition and because of the camera animation, because it gets blocked here and then it reveals the city slowly. And also this tree is just to block out the view, right? It's just to block the view on the left. You're supposed to look here. And that's what I did also on the lighting part. Let me open it again. Because I also had a version where this would be more brighter, but it's so distracting, right? So the lighting in the scene is made especially like it's made like this because there's a reason for it, right? If you would illuminate the whole scene equally, it would look boring and you wouldn't know where to look. That's why we decided to make the whole foreground rather dark and just some little accents on the right, and the rest, the whole lighting will get like this, the whole city gets hit by the light, only the city and everything surrounding here, because obviously you can't block the light here, it doesn't make sense. But here, this whole part is dark. There's a reason why I placed the cliff here, because the lighting is leading the eye to the city. And that's why we also created these God rays, because you will not look here because it's just bright. You want to see where the main contrast is, and the main contrast point is here. The camera is like this is a quite a central composition, but this is so bright here. This is so dark, and where's the contrast point? In the middle here. So this is where you should look. And yeah. Anything else about the composition? I don't think so. Did I forget anything? Anything you want to add, Lars or Arvid or Andrea, if he's here? Or yeah, just like ask questions. You can ask questions all the time. There are no stupid questions. Just ask anything you want to know. Doesn't matter. All good on last side, okay? I'll let you write the questions. Render time per frame. That's a good question. We had a version with 1 second, let me open the render settings. We had a version with a lot of render time, like 30 minutes, but then I talked to one of the lead artists at ILM, and he said I should try Radiance Map and Brute Force because it's like cheating the GI calculation. Like Radiance Map is super fast, so we did that, and it's just actually in the beginning it was very low, and then just multi-frame incremental. It was super fast. It was like 12 minutes in the beginning. Like here, it was like 12 minutes only on the first frames, on the first like 40 frames, and then it went up to like 15 to 17, depending on how much of the background you see, you know. Yeah, like here it would only take like 10 minutes on super noise-free settings, and here it was like, yeah, 12 or 17. The resolution was 2K, like 2K anamorphic lens. So it's like really wide. And yeah, the block flock of birds is just a comp, right? It's just comp. And like I said, Lars will upload the tutorial how he made it. I guess it's probably like a particle. Like simple particle setup. I don't know. He will show it. Yeah, the motion blur was done after rendering in Nuke. Because it just takes too long for this kind of scene, and it's my headset died again. Awesome. So I would only do motion blur in the render when you have like crazy camera movement, or you have things which are rotating, like car wheels. They just look better in 3D motion blur. But for an animation like this, there was no reason to render the motion blur. It will increase the render time so much, and you don't get real profit of it. Lars just told me it's a tool from Nukepedia, so the flock of birds. So probably like a gizmo, I don't know. But like I said, just wait for the tutorial, which will come out, and you can see everything. Oh yeah, exactly what Johnny said. Or when you see moving stuff through transparency, it just looks better. He will mention it in the tutorial, he said. So no worries about that one. Yeah. Oh, cool. Cool. Anything else? We talked about lighting, we talked about the composition. Yeah. Oh, by the way, we had on the in the first like week I had the idea of doing it like Weta, because I'm gonna open the Weta breakdown, because it's really an interesting video. And what they did is they didn't do everything in 3D, which I maybe also wanted to try, because what they did is they just built this 3D foreground, and then they just matte painted the rest, right? And you can actually see this is from the reference pack I bought. So I this maybe we it was worth a try, but I wanted to have full control in 3D, so we decided to do a full 3D shot, and it looks quite like kind of similar. So yeah, I mean it makes sense here for this shot, because it's it just saves a lot of time, you know. Yeah, but pretty cool stuff. Pretty cool stuff. Pretty cool stuff. Yeah. Alrighty. I would say for the squares you use to block HDLED lighting. What do you mean for the squares? Which squares? You mean in the foreground? If you mean the light blocker in the foreground, this is just a huge plane with a black material which has no reflection, no reflection. Squares over the whole scene. Oh, this is not. I didn't light block anything in this scene. You can see here. I don't have anything turned on. This is just the light gets blocked by the cliffs naturally, because the sun in the HDRI is somewhere here. And the light gets blocked by these cliffs here, right? And these cliffs here on this side. So there's a reason why I rotated the HDRI on this side, so it gets hit. It hits only the city. I did. It was a quite a process to rotate it around until it looked the way I wanted. And if I could, I would have done it. So the one shrine also gets hit. So this shrine was out of light already, but I tried to move it around. But when the light hits this shrine, this part doesn't get the light. So I rather wanted this whole thing here to gets hit by the light than this thing here. Yeah. But I didn't block anything at all. This is just natural lighting behavior. I only used the light blocker for the foreground. No, the buildings don't have UVs. I told Andrea to not do UVs. It's a waste of time. I use triplanar for them anyways, because they're so far away and so small. No reason to do UVs. And also I told him to not bevel anything, you know. This is just it just hard edges, and worst case I can create a soft edges in the shader. But no need for that, because it's so far away. It was would be a waste of render time. Yeah, and in the end, freeze everything and hit render, and that's all. Yeah? All I can do, and the rest is done in. Oh, maybe I can show the grading, because that's also kind of interesting. Because the comp looked still like color wise, it looked still like my raw render. So I can actually show you the raw render as well, because it's in here, the raw comp. Let me open it in a second. It takes a bit, because it's 4K. Because a fun fact, but guys, rendered in 2K, but the final image is 4K, and I did that by using a plugin from I don't know the company's name, but it's called Scale Up. And let me, oh my god, my computer's dying. I need to close Max really quick. This is the dirty way, but I saved anyway, so fuck you, Max. Fuck you. Die! Okay. Give me a second, guys, it's loading. My whole computer's dying right now. Holy shit, okay. Okay. Give it a second to load. Okay. So this is how it looks graded. Maybe go a bit forward. Oh yeah, it's I don't know, it's using so much RAM. But to be fair, it's also 4K, so it takes a long time to calculate all this stuff, you know. I think the render times for the whole thing in After Effects was like, I don't know, 30 minutes or 40 minutes. But it's a really good upscaling. It's a really good upscaling tool. I always do it like this now. Render in 1080 and then holy shit, this is so slow. Okay, so maybe I have to clear the cache really quick because this is not this is so slow, this is so disgusting. Okay, you know what? I'm opening the normal version, the 1080 version, because this is disgusting. Fuck it. This is too slow. So what I did is I rendered this out as AVI, and then I put it in Sony Vegas, which is my cutting program. Really old school. It looks like this. Really old school. When I did this setup, just put everything together with music and blending and all that whatnot, you know. And then, fun fact, I bought this for $20 on Humble Bundle. Yeah, and then I rendered this out as AVI again, and then I put it in my encoder, which is called Handbrake. My eyes, ah. Yeah, it doesn't have a night mode, I think. Yeah, this is an awesome tool. You can like it's really great quality. I do it on every of my videos. Just put it in and then convert it to an MP4. It's like H.264 codec, I think. Yeah, it's really, really good quality. The waterfalls are fluid sims, yes. They are done in Houdini. But we didn't put the particles or anything in Max. It's just Arvid rendered out the waterfalls inside Houdini, and then I used them as an animated texture on planes. Just simple, simple thing. Okay, so this should be. Oh yeah, this is way better. Okay, so finally it works. So this is the comp. This is the comp version. This is how it looks. This is basically the raw render with comp elements on it, like the sky, the god rays, the flares, all the birds, you know. And then I did the grading, and it looks completely different. But this is how it works in production as well. Ungraded footage looks always worse and not that nice. So what I did is I used based off a preset, pretty simple. It's called what is it called again, Lars? I don't know. Somewhere here is a Dreamlock? No? No? No. I don't know. Okay, it was some preset, but this is just how it looks, you know. It's just just some saturation, desaturate it a bit, make it diffuse so it gets a nice light hit, and then make it warmer so it looks more like sunrise. Warm and fuzzy was the preset. Thank you. So this is the and then make it a bit more bright and get the shadows a bit back, you know. Then desaturate it a bit, and this is like a clamp to clamp, not get these like super bright highlights here. And yeah, that's it. That's the grading, and that's the final look. You can see this is a huge difference, but that's how it works. That's just how it works. Are these details getting lost? No, I would not say that. I wouldn't say the details get lost. I mean, it will still look different. If the details were not there, you know. And yeah, this is you can see the quality here. It's not that great because it's just 1080, and the upscale looks so crisp and sharp. I can really recommend the plugin Scale Up, guys. It's called yeah, this one, Scale Up. It's super nice. Like 200, I think this one is the 4K. Yeah, this is 4K, and then you can just click on bicubic, and it's like super sharp. Okay, of course this comp is not 4K, so let's put it to 4K really quick. Yeah, so this is 4K. This is like super crisp now. That's a really cool, really cool. Yeah, plugin, I would say. Okay, that's it. If you don't have any more questions, I would say we are done for today. Any final questions, guys? One hour 11, that's pretty good. The last master class was 1 hour, so that's a good time. Hey Ori. Right as I got back home. Unlucky, but I recorded this whole class, so no worries. I will wait a bit more for questions, and otherwise I would say we're done. If you want to ask questions, I'm gonna post it here again. I will tag everyone. I will just add here everyone. So, yep. How many years have you been doing 3D work? I started 2018. Yeah, 2000 somewhere to early 2018. I think January or so. Can you share the raw renders without the comp work? Do you mean you want the renders themselves? You mean the XR files? Ah, just showing. Oh yeah, I can show them. I will open Nuke really quick. But yeah, like I said, Lars, he will make a tutorial on his YouTube channel about this compositing work, so you will see them there as well. So let me set up Aces really quick, then open the shot. Projects ribbon there. Okay, where are the renders? Renders. I think this one. Yeah, this looks right. Now this is the raw render. Any specific? Yes, because can I share my LinkedIn? Yeah, just search my name, Steffen Hampel. All right, I can show it. That's my LinkedIn. You can just search it. And yeah, the reason why I did my grading in After Effects is because I used to It doesn't matter, Mubu. It doesn't matter which aces you use. The color space is still the same. There's only slight differences in what kind of LUTs they add, you know. But it doesn't make a difference at all. If you use 1.2, 1.043 or whatnot, I don't know. It doesn't matter that much. That's aces CG is aces CG, you know. And actually. My render setup is Aces CG in max. It's Aces CG. It's not Aces 1. Anything. I just use the OCIO to view transform it in my V-Ray frame buffer. So this is the raw render, guys. And you might see some flickering, especially here. The waterfall is disappearing for a frame or so. But it's not, you can't see it in the final render because it's hidden. But like I said in my other masterclass in the arrival shot and in the Blade Runner shot, you just have to know how it should look in comp and grading later, so you know what you have to do in 3D. And I knew that this is gonna be enough for as a starting point, you know. The textures on the buildings are all done procedurally. The textures are not generally, they're not created procedurally, but the shaders are procedural. So I used like mega scans and CG textures and whatnot, and just made different versions of them, and then triplanar projection on the geometry with offsets, and that's it. Every roof looks different, and I think I even have a diffuse pass. Yeah, you see, there's like an offset on each roof. Every off roof looks different, right? That's all in the shader. There's like two or three different shaders, but they all have a different variation of the texture. They have random U, random gamma, random saturation, and all that. You know, you can see it really looks different from each other. I don't know if you already mentioned, but how much resource did you need for rendering? What do you mean? I have a good CPU. I have a. Let me search really quick. This is my CPU. Yeah. So 16 cores means 32 threads. So it's a pretty good computer. But yeah, it's still pretty good render times. Like only 10 to 15, 17 minutes. It's a really good render time for this kind of shot. A lot of geometry. And a lot of two-sided materials, like every tree has a proper shader, so Lars, can you show the comp to compare to the raw render? Oh yeah, I can do that. I can do that again in 1 second. This is the raw render. And the comp already looks way different. By the way, I also had a version where we can you show please? I didn't do the compositing. Compositing was done by Lars Lemire. He's also in this channel right now. His name is LoveVFX. I will show his YouTube again. 1 second. I will show his YouTube again. Lars Lemire. This is his channel, LoveVFX. Just look it up on YouTube. Thank you for posting it, Johnny. So that's his YouTube. He will post the tutorial about the compositing of the shot in 2 weeks, roughly in 2 weeks. That's what you have to check out. And this is yeah, I can show you the. This is the comp and this is the raw render. I mean, there's already a huge difference. Especially those God rays, they help so much. And yeah. Any tutorials from this guy? Ready to pay? Don't worry, it will come on his YouTube. Just subscribe on his YouTube channel and he will post it in the next I don't know, 2 weeks. A nuke? What do you mean, Lars? Can you show the comp to compare it? Oh, you mean I should put it into you. I can't do that, Lars, because you sent me a MOV and I can't open that in Nuke non-commercial. I don't have a Nuke license, so I can't open it. I can only open XR and all that shit, you know. Okay, guys, I would say that's it. Thank you for tuning in. I will upload this on my YouTube channel, so if you missed something out, I will probably cover it. I probably covered it in the video. So, we will post, or Arvid will post a link to the video once it's on YouTube. And otherwise, if you already want to subscribe to my YouTube channel, which is, oh God, what's my YouTube channel? One second. Got it? No. Okay, found it here. This is the channel. Just you can follow me here. I upload like you can also watch the Blade Runner, like this shot, the breakdown of this shot. I also did a masterclass if you haven't watched it yet. Alrighty, boys and girls. Thanks for tuning in. This show is over. I'll stop the recording.